I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the Eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Public for an audio recording, which will be used to ensure an accurate record of proceedings produced in the minutes of the meeting. All comments made in open session will be recorded. First up, our hearing tonight is for a proposal from the select. Did you just lost? Hold on one second. They're proposing a zoning bylaw change, and this is a public hearing for Article 21 to see if the town will vote to amend the town zoning bylaw by adding a new section, marijuana establishments. Marijuana establishments that would provide as follow, and further to amend the table of contents to add section blank, marijuana establishments, section blank. Consistent with GLC 94G 3A2, all types of marijuana establishments as defined in GLC 94G 1J to include marijuana cultivators, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturers, marijuana retailers, or any other types of licensed marijuana-related businesses shall be prohibited within the town of Pembroke. This section shall be effective upon passage by the voters at a town election or take any other action relative thereto. This is supported by the Board of Selectmen. So why don't we open with, is there anyone here from the Selectmen who'd like to speak on this?
Absolutely. Thank you, Dan, and the rest of the board for allowing me to speak on this matter. The Selectmen and another committee with the Chief have spoken about this before, and we feel that this article will allow the town to make it decide its own future on whether or not to allow marijuana retail shops in the town of Pembroke. And that's why I support it. If it doesn't pass, it will save the taxpayers a lot of money, according to the chief and according to his resources. But if it does pass, it's the will of the people. So that's why I feel that this is the best option for Pembroke.
Does the board have any questions?
Well, I guess my question is, what impact would this have on our medical marijuana bylaw? Because it does refer to any other types of licensed marijuana-related businesses.
Well, they're two separate entities.
But the language of this bylaw would appear to encompass medical marijuana facilities with the broad language, any other type of licensed marijuana-related businesses. Is there an intent to include medical marijuana facilities, or is the intent that those would be separately relegated to the zone where they're allowed at this time?
The intent is to prohibit retail and commercial marijuana distribution, testing, cultivation, growing.
And where is that medical?
So it did not include medical?
It was not intended to.
By the very nature of the current bylaw and this, it would include medical because medical marijuana allows for cultivation, manufacturing, and retail.
Testing.
It's the same thing.
Right. I had a question. I guess during one of your discussions, I guess Chief Wall had stated that I guess that there would be additional costs to maintain appropriate public safety levels that would offset any revenue received. And I was just curious, what would be the increases in those? What would be the public safety concern?
I don't know what the full impact would be. It depends on how many retail, how many establishments are in Pembroke, and how many are in other communities. If we're the only community that has one, it's going to increase a lot of traffic. It's going to increase a lot of police presence, which we don't have.
So you would have a police officer there, but not in a liquor store?
No, I wouldn't necessarily have a police officer there, but there are going to be some security issues that we're going to deal with. There's going to be issues that I can't even foresee right now because it hasn't been done yet.
Chief, how many issues do you have right now with the illegal use of recreation marijuana? And when you think it's going to increase if they're allowed to buy a legal?
I have no idea what it's going to, what kind of an impact that it's going to have. Again, there's a lot of factors that are involved with that. Thought process on this all was that the townspeople didn't vote to support article ballot question number 4. It was defeated in Pembroke. So they should have the opportunity whether or not to allow retail. I think it's going to change kind of the look and feel of Pembroke depending on how many other communities adopt it or don't adopt it.
So it was defeated by 143 votes out of 10,000, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a mandate?
It wasn't passed.
Okay.
I guess part of my question right now is, where do we stand at the state level? My understanding was that there was supposed to be some attempt at the state level, which I haven't followed very closely. I'm sure you followed more closely than I have, to try to regulate how and where facilities might be located or what kind of licensing, you know, even if it's legal, that doesn't mean there wouldn't be any licensing or something along those lines. Do you know where the state efforts at licensing these types of facilities stands?
So there's more questions than answers right now on that. I mean, they haven't fully put together all of the regulations. They don't even have the board put together for all of the for all these regulations. So
it's not
they're asking us to take a leap of faith and then hoping that we can do something, yet I think we have the ability as a town to have local control and develop our own zoning, our own planning, and our own prohibition if we so choose.
But currently there is a moratorium in place at the state level, right?
They bumped it out another 6 months.
Yep.
I think it's July of 19 now, but again, under the regulations, the state can allow if there isn't anything to the contrary, up to 75 licenses for each of the growing, cultivation, retail. So this
statewide,
and that's
on the initial
so
passing of licenses.
They would be able to procure those licenses in this time between now and what, July of 2019.
I'm not sure when the process goes, but again, there's something in the thing that if the commission doesn't have all of their rules in place, that licenses will be issued and then they'll be regulated after the fact.
So they have kind of a timeline
right
set in place with a deadline that they have to meet, I think.
I guess one of my concerns is that we could open ourselves up by not allowing it anywhere in town. One of the issues sometimes seems to be that if you become too exclusionary, you can almost get it forced upon you through litigation anywhere in town. And did you guys look at and consider the possibility of adopting a permitted zone similar to medical marijuana that would give us at least some control if the license came to town. Hopefully, the licenses will come with some measure of local control, the way the medical marijuana has been played out. But if it might come to town, would we be better off relegating it to a part of town where we have a little more control over our district than risking litigation that would perhaps have it end up somewhere else?
Well, some towns have already put it on their ballot.
Yeah.
Westboro already has. Other towns have done moratoriums to postpone it, but it's already got a 6-month moratorium on top of that. So, in all that I've read from the Mass Municipal Attorneys and stuff, that they recommended that you go ahead with if you want to do a prohibition, go ahead with it at a town meeting, followed up with a ballot, that way you're covered. Because one part of the law is a vote of the voters in order to have a prohibition. And it's the recommended choice. Right now, there's still a lot of gray areas here. Matter of fact, some of the things that were promised that were supposed to be intact in the initial law in December when it became active and people were allowed to possess marijuana, is children under the age of 18 with possession of marijuana, they're supposed to be issued a fine of $100, have their marijuana confiscated, notify the parents, and then they're supposed to attend a 4-hour drug awareness class. Well, there is no 4-hour drug awareness class that I can find.
I mean, it's just not available.
It's just not there. It hasn't been, they haven't figured that part out yet. So
we could do it and make some money for the town.
Yeah, I'm not sure that, you know, I want to get involved with, you know, not being protected and having the laws determined later. I don't think that's a good way to set policy. And I think the only options that we have is either adopt zoning and allow it, or have a prohibition and not allow it. So, again, in the purest form, let the voters decide if they want to have retail, then zone it. If they don't want to have retail, then prohibit it.
This article, as presented, if it's voted down, it may become a ballot question for the November election. That was just answered.
Well, it would be voted up.
Yeah, you'd still have it on the ballot in the spring, but it would be a non-binding referendum on the ballot. If it was not passed at town meeting.
Okay, I see. So it's going to
be. It would still be on the ballot.
It's on the ballot now.
Right.
Yeah, and that would be, if anything, that would be a good bellwether as to what, you know, where the town wanted to go. On the other hand, I don't think we're going to have a very huge turnout for the election.
For either election.
Yeah, so it may not be a good indicator of, you know, of public sentiment. But, however, you know,
it's on the ballot. Either way, it's going to be on the ballot, and the voters in the whole town will be able to, not just the folks in town.
Right.
Okay, I agree with that.
Would you guys consider amending the language to exclude medical marijuana applications?
This has been through town council, and it's the same language that was on the on Westboro's. So, you know, I have to confer with town council before I go ahead and change things. But they didn't see any issues with it, or would have made it to this point.
Westboro has an additional marijuana bylaw. So maybe it on the bench.
Well, the risk with total prohibition is it may not hold up in court with challenges.
Right.
You know, and at that point, I don't think we can feel that if we put a total prohibition in the room that we would be done with our work. That similar to the medical marijuana zoning bylaw that we put into effect, we took some time to really look at it, especially as the state legislature was looking at it at the same time. There was a moratorium at that time. It gave us some time to look at zoning and where we thought, had this continued on, that, you know, we'd be able to relegate it to one part of town and kind of control it, so it wouldn't be able to be anywhere. This is a kind of a similar situation where it may be prudent to hold off on a total prohibition and look at zoning bylaws that would enable us to put it in one part of town over another, where it could at least be controlled. that could be a better way to look at this. That also would give us some time, in conjunction with the time being taken at the state, to take a look at all the gray areas and start to make them black and white. Because there is a lot of things that are up in the air about this today, things that we don't know, that could change significantly between now and, you know, 2019. I do think that looking at it from the perspective of giving towns some more leeway in how they handle this at a local level, and I think they'd like to see the local jurisdictions have some more control over it in the long term.
But I'm not sure that's written into the law itself, because I think the control for all of this, unlike the alcohol, the control is going to be with the board, the cannabis board, and not with the local town. So I think you're limited as far as what you can do, as far as control. You can zone it, but as far as other conditions, I don't think you have much of an option.
And either way, we're still faced with the legality issue anyway, correct? I mean, there are still people can still possess.
Yes. It doesn't affect anybody's individual right to possess marijuana. To carry it on their person, to keep it in their homes, to grow in their own homes. It doesn't affect any of that. It affects the retail, commercial growing, and again, something else coming down the line eventually will be whether or not you want consumables, having a pot bar, having people be able to consume marijuana products at a retail establishment. And that opens up a whole nother can of worms.
Right now, when you have marijuana that's on the streets, right? We know there's a lot of marijuana out there on the streets. There's no real control over that substance, right? Is there any expectation that the recreational marijuana board is going to put controls over the quality, purity? You know, as a parent, I worry about, if my child ever tried it, would he end up with something laced with PCP and or something worse, right? I have a 10-year-old, so hopefully it's some time away for him to face that decision or to have it thrust upon him. But, you know, it's a scary world out there for parents. And my question is, will this make it safer or less safe?
I think it makes it more accessible on both sides, legally and illegally. I think you're going to have more marijuana because now people are going to be able to carry it openly. You're not going to be able to tell where it comes from. It's, you know, you're not going to be able to know that unless you go to the store and buy it. I mean, you're still going to be able to get illegal marijuana on the streets. You're going to be able to get homegrown marijuana from pretty much anybody that has the ability to grow it. So it just makes it more accessible.
So what
I'm not going to say it makes it any safer.
Okay.
But will it make it more controllably accessible than those other sources that you know? You know, with a retail establishment, there could be some quality control and safety issues, maybe security issues around it. I'm not sure, compared to what's available on the street or from someone who may be growing it at home. I see both sides of the issue, in other words. But, you know, today, you know, the prohibition is going to change a lot of things that are happening today that are some of the problems. So that's not going to change anything materially. It just keeps a retail establishment from coming into town and setting up shop. But that could be 3, 4, 5 years away anyway, based on what's going on at the state level.
I don't think so. I think by 2019, whether they have an established plan or not, the licenses are going to be coming out, and there's a tremendous amount of money in marijuana. You're going to have retail establishments. So if you don't plan for that, you don't prepare for that, they're coming and they'll be here. So it's a question of whether or not, do you want to have that in your town, or do you not want to have it in your town? And again, I have my own personal opinions. I would prefer that the people can do what they want to do.
I was just going to say, with the medicinal marijuana law, I think, was I just reading today or yesterday or something, that within the state of the 75 or 95 or whatever it was, I think the first one is like getting set to open. And how many years ago was that bylaw?
Three.
Goes
back 3 quarters,
right?
Yeah, I don't think we have anything to fear from the idea that from a state law point of view, that this will remain a prohibited use until such time as the Department of Revenue, apparently, who can promulgate rules in this matter, opens up the licensing procedure. And consequently, we know in the medical marijuana side, even though that was adopted, again, about 3 or 4 years ago at this point, are very slow of a rollout to actually provide patients with access. One of the things I have to question for you, Chief, recently it was determined a company in Brockton, for instance, would be allowed, and others will too, to deliver these products. Mm-hmm. And consequently, they would be licensed, I assume. So are we also prohibiting outside providers to provide the residents of Pembroke?
No, I don't think that we can stop the transportation.
But your bylaw reads in a very broad way, licensed marijuana-related businesses.
Right.
Plural.
So the business would be excluded from Pembroke, but not doing business if they were from Brockton or wherever.
There's but no yours doesn't state that specifically.
I don't think it states that they can't.
Well, again, the language I'm reading to you, other types of licensed marijuana-related businesses, you're not specifically outlining in this case or prohibiting retail businesses within the town of Pembroke. That language would satisfy me. The language provided here leaves a big opening as to determine what that means. And that's why I'm mostly opposed to this bylaw as presented. Way too broad. It precedes state regulation. Does not necessarily provide any public safety. And I can't see why this board would be in favor of establishing this or approving of this for town meeting, unless there are better arguments to be made. I have heard nothing to date on this that would be compelling enough to suggest that this board act prior to the state regulations being promulgated that will regulate this industry.
No, I feel that having this approved at town meeting is step one. Mm-hmm. Step two is the ballot question. If the ballot question doesn't pass, this goes away. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And we're back to square one again. And I think this gives the public an opportunity to look at it. When we vote in May after town meeting, we vote to see whether or not we're going to keep this or not. That's going to be the end.
No, I don't think that's the case.
You don't think so?
Yeah. Eventually, another citizen's petition would be offered that simply says, undo this.
Okay,
but here's the point. This is the way it's been procedurally set up, is to attempt to obviously get approval of this board. It's an important first step. Mm-hmm. And then immediately, within a week's time, bring it before the voters of a town election. Town election in this case with very few persons represented on the ballot. Probably will represent the average town election turnout. 1,500 people out of 11,500. Is that really representative of how the town might feel?
Is it? I think it's better than 150 yeah. that are going to be a town meeting.
Oh, granted. I don't think any town meeting actually has state law without the final election behind it.
No.
I'm just saying it's not the ideal election to contest. Consequently, I think this, if you have a very low turnout, this law will be questioned again. Our pro-moratorium would be questioned, and it would probably become an article again for a general election of more the state election magnitude or a presidential again. So, and I'm not opposed to moratorium in a very temporary sense of the word, a year, 18 months. But I'm not happy with the idea that 1,500 odd people show up for dog calling elections and then determine public policy. And, but here's the other point to this, Tom. We talked about not taking that, not allowing this activity. The board of selectmen in the past have voted against the medical marijuana growing facility, if I recall, right? Here's an operation that would probably, again, provide retail revenue, I should say, to the town. We're denying this revenue to the town. The state adopts a regulation that provides a redistribution of marijuana revenues to towns, all 351 of them. If we deny this sort of activity in our town, are we prepared to deny the revenue the state would distribute to us as well?
Chief? Question I can answer.
I'm just wondering how far we're willing to go in terms of denying. In Colorado, just quickly, Colorado, they are funding an education system, essentially, revenue generated by medical marijuana in general. So I don't know if we're kind of punching our nose in spite of our face.
But I think Colorado's probably not a good example because they have a lot of issues that they're dealing with, and they have towns can opt out, or actually they opt in to the retail, so not every community has marijuana. You have to opt in for that. So here, we're looking to opt out, and that's all I'm asking.
Oh,
because there's too many unknowns with where this is going to go. And if some of the simpler things haven't been ironed out yet, I'm not expecting that all the big issues are going to be ironed out either.
I guess my question is, if we have 2 years for licenses, why would we handle this next year when we might have more clarity? We'd still be a year in advance of the licenses.
I'm going to take a longer look.
Please.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just two comments jumped to mind right away. One, I'm a little concerned that we're not putting forth information to the residents to make a decision on, because we're concerned of who's going to show up at town meeting or who's going to show up at an election. I mean, these are open environs for the citizens of the town to make their voices known, and if we're going to pre-decide for them based on what we think the turnout will be, I'm a little concerned about as a government procedural program, what we'll only put forth zoning or other regulations on meetings and ballots where we think that the more people will come. I mean, if we did that with town meeting, we might never have a town meeting again. The second point would be, I hear clearly this idea that we have until 2019. That is not what I'm hearing from the Mass Department of Public Health side. This is going to have a tremendous impact on the health department of the town of Pembroke, Massachusetts, because when it is decriminalized and it moves into other venues, there is talk that this will come out down under Mass Department of Public Health. And I hear correctly the commentary of, well, it might bring us revenue. But I want you to think, what will it cost? What will it cost in enforcement and inspections and everything else?
What would it cost?
I can't even begin to fathom. You're talking about, you know, someone who gets garbage complaints every other day by neighbors next to each other. Right. What happens when it's Joe smoking joints out on his deck? That's non-criminal. The police can't even respond to that. Therefore, it goes down to a nuisance complaint level. Who do you think gets that phone call? Depending on how prevalent this becomes, I couldn't even begin to tell you. We could meet a whole full-time person just for this issue.
Yeah, but with all due respect, mm-hmm. that has nothing to do with the retail sales, because the legalization of marijuana is going to happen
correct.
Regardless. So
correct.
That situation could happen whether there's a prohibition or not.
You're absolutely correct, but the more there is, the more there will be. That is a fact as well. My understanding is personal growth is supposed to be for personal growth, and yes, there will still be some sales from that, which will be illegal. My understanding is personal, and correct me anywhere I'm wrong, Chief, that's still not supposed to be for intent to distribute. That's
no,
for personal use.
That's correct.
No, so when you have a retail establishment...
I talking about, like if you have retail
correct.
In Rushfield, or you have retail in...
Correct,
Rockton,
people can cross lines and purchase
absolutely. How much is available in town. To residents
well, no, what I really meant was that there's a legalization issue that will be in effect soon, right?
It's already done.
It's
correct.
Already done.
Yeah, decided.
Right. Correct.
That people already have the legal right to
correct.
Smoke a joint on their deck.
Absolutely.
So those quality of life issues are going to happen regardless of whether there's a retail establishment or not.
Mm-hmm.
They're happening. They've been going on for 50 years, as far as I can tell.
Well, I guess
all of my adult life.
Lisa, it sounds like most of the concern is in the bylaw itself is just so broadly written that it.
That I understand.
We have a lot of questions. Does
understood.
It like
and yes, always to this act, a bylaw is always a good thing. That I completely understand and wholeheartedly
right.
agree with. And if amendments are necessary, I'm sure that they would be welcomed.
But we do have a precedent here where we've taken some time. In light of a request for prohibition when the medical marijuana law passed, we were presented with an article very similar to this for prohibition in Pembroke. We decided not to take it up at that time. We took some more time to look into the issue in more depth because, again, a lot of the gray areas were going to become more black and white as a result of taking a little bit more time with it. And then we decided to do a zoning bylaw change, which kept it in one part of town. And so far, we've been able to keep medical marijuana facility outside of Pembroke, but still stay within the law. I think in this case, we may want to think about that as well. There could be prohibition in the future, if that makes sense for us. But there's still too many unanswered questions.
Interesting to your point, Andy. There was a article in the New York Times yesterday, Sunday edition, under the business news section. The byline from Quincy, Massachusetts, displayed a large factory facility in Quincy that's now growing medicinal marijuana. The bylaw prohibition that you just brought up was recommended to us by the City of Quincy Council. Okay? That now in his district has a medical marijuana facility growing substantial amounts of marijuana for the benefit of the City of Quincy, obviously, they wouldn't have adopted it. So, what goes around comes around, as they say. And, Chief, all respect, the way this one's written up right now deserves further review. I make a motion to the effect that we continue this public hearing to a date certain and continue to collect information and try to perhaps craft something to come into the fall town meeting, which may be more appropriate. So I'll motion to that effect that we continue the public hearing.
I will second that.
We have debate on the question?
Sure, we should.
My question is if we take up that motion and table it, what happens to the ballot question? Does it stay on the ballot? And therefore, when we take it up again at town meeting, we would already know the outcome of the ballot question?
No, the ballot question would become essentially non-binding.
But it would
it's
become
only
advisory.
An opinion poll. It's an opinion poll. So.
Would it change the impact of the... If the ballot question happened in the spring and the town meeting happened in the fall, would that change anything in terms of the ultimate force of the law?
I don't believe so, but that's something we would have to direct through council as to how we would like to proceed. I do not feel, though, if the my opinion is that if this is not adopted or not voted upon at town meeting, then the ballot initiative would have to be non-binding. There was no town bylaw adopted in the first case.
And I'm not sure I fully understand why does the ballot change the legal impact?
You need it certified by the voters in town to, in fact, install the regulation that the chief is seeking, is that correct? That's the validation.
That's
the
zoning
bylaw,
right?
Even this
that's
is...
That's the they wouldn't be going after the ballot. They wouldn't go put it on the ballot just for kicks.
I see what you're saying. There may be a prohibition in effect because of a vote at the ballot box, but no zoning bylaw in effect. Is that the question?
Right. But the zoning bylaw, we don't typically pass zoning bylaw changes at the ballot box.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, council has indicated that to supersede a state referendum question,
right,
it has to be supported by a local vote.
Okay.
Zoning bylaws don't go in general out to election.
That's my point. And so does it matter the order?
So my understanding, again, I'm not a law person, town meetings, but they recommend you do twofold. That you do the zoning bylaw, because zoning bylaws tend to have greater impact on the state, because it's that home rule that they really want people to try and govern themselves. But there's still gray area as to the law on how this has to be passed, because one of the things in the law says that it has to be a vote of the voters. And there's a question that no one's been able to answer, whether or not that's a town meeting vote or an election vote, so they recommend that you do both. That's why we're doing both.
But they don't necessarily have to be in any particular order.
No, they don't. But I think if you passed the ballot question, it would supersede any zoning bylaw, and that you would have to go amend that.
Well, no, if they pass it at the, well...
The point is, we don't know at this time if it'll stand alone. Given the information we have in front of us, it could stand alone as a ballot item. My understanding, again, Chief, stop me when I'm wrong, you do both because we are not given clear and definitive answers of which alone would stand. When that is decided, it could be possible that just for being on the ballot, it may stand independently. Mm-hmm. It may not have to go to a town meeting article.
All right, as it stands right now, this article is not that hasn't been.
It's on the ballot. The ballots are being printed as far as I know.
But it's also a town meeting.
It is on the warrant.
And all that we're being asked to tonight is to make a recommendation. Whether we agree or disagree with the denial, it's still going to be on the ballot. All we're going to say is we disagree with it. All we agree with it.
Right.
End of story.
Well, no, right now I think the motion that's on the floor is that we don't vote to agree or disagree, but right. That we delay our decision to gather more data.
I understand,
sir.
But I would not agree. But the point being that no matter what we do, the article is still on the town meeting warrant, and it's going to be voted on at town meeting regardless of what the planning board says. Correct?
No.
No?
No.
All right, clarify, Brian, please.
My understanding would be this, similar to the medical marijuana law in the proceedings there. The board took no action, planning board took no action on medical marijuana. Basically, it's the same arguments we used tonight.
Yeah, right.
Okay. And consequently, that continuation of public hearing meant that there was no recommendation of the planning board before town meeting. Okay. This has been complicated because it's already been inserted onto the ballot. In anticipation, I guess, that it could pass at town meeting. Okay. Consequently, that action would be almost immediate, a matter of days. Before this would come before voters. This is highly time for people on either side to try to organize their efforts. In my view, that's the problem here. So, to the question of the ballot, though, itself, the one that goes before those people on that Saturday, they could vote either way, but because there's been no adoption of a zoning bylaw, the underpinning of the whole thing, the zoning bylaw, has not been approved.
Yeah.
Then what did the voters approve? They only gave an opinion then to the zoning bylaw itself, which was not adopted. So as a result, I think that that ballot question becomes non-binding. But I'll leave it to the attorneys to go figure that one out.
If it's approved at town meeting,
yeah.
Then, and if it's approved at the election, it becomes
law. Local law.
Right.
You can't bring it up at town meeting unless this board acts to bring it to town meeting. It's a zoning matter.
Okay. I just reading it. It is being forwarded to the planning board, please schedule to consider a recommendation for town meeting.
That's right. We're making none.
We're making none.
So just saying we want more time to digest the issue.
That's the motion that's on the floor right now.
That's the motion I'm seeking is to digest.
Okay.
Essentially give the opportunity for both parties or any parties to come forward and resolve this at the next town meeting.
All right. So we have the motion on the floor.
You need a date and time certain for the continuation of the public hearing.
All right. What date would you like for us?
June.
Monday after May 9th.
No, I would say June if we're going to take time to get some data.
Either way.
All right. Want to do the second week of June?
It has to be post-town meeting.
June 9th? That would be our first planning board meeting.
I think June 9th is a Friday.
Oh, wait, I'm looking at 2014. Oh, all right. How about June 12th?
June 12th, I think, would be the second Monday in June.
So what time?
7 p.m. Pretty much later. Seven.
So I have a question. Why wouldn't you do your homework and bring it up before the town meeting?
Because the state isn't going to even act on this probably until July. We're waiting for the state action. We're one of 351 cities and towns in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. So, you know, let's see how the law plays out. Let's see what happens. That's what we're doing here, essentially, is saying, let's let some period of commentary and whatever happen at that state level. I mean, yes, Pembroke voted against it at that election in November, but the state voted something like 58-42 to endorse. We're part of the Commonwealth, after all.
They only need a civics lesson. What I'm asking you is, why wouldn't you take the time to look over the medical and medicinal marijuana law, which was well-crafted and had a lot of things, and then read over the 27 pages of this and look at the ambiguities and see if you can't come to the same conclusion that I came to before the town meeting and before you tank this just out of principle, when you really should be doing the research to do it. Have you read all of this already? Have you already gone through all of this?
I think that, again, that acting on zoning articles prior to both the state legislature and Department of Revenue, I believe, to redo this is premature.
This is the exact same thing we did with medicinal marijuana law.
Premature.
And the current moratorium still gives us time and protects the town in the time period that we would do to take a closer look at this.
There is a moratorium in effect. Right.
Just understand that when that moratorium's over, they're going to issue licenses whether we're ready or they're ready.
Correct. But we have, whether it be July 18 or July of 19, to essentially find out what that regulation would be from the state as to who can operate, how they operate, all the things that go with that.
Well, it could in fact make a prohibition decided at the local level even stronger. Than it would be now, before that work would be done. Because anything that we pass now, prohibition that we pass too quickly, could be challenged in court. And as likely, I think likely to be challenged in court.
And further, just on the questions raised this evening about the language involved with this particular bylaw that's before us tonight. Now you say, I don't think that really, includes delivery servicers, product servicers, or other things. But that's kind of an opinionation of it, if you will. There's nothing that I could stick to in the law, whether it be 27 pages or 57 pages, that may specify my question. Are these delivery services going to be illegal? All it says is all related businesses. And that is a very wide cover. Too wide, in my view, in terms of anybody related to this venture. Anybody. Forget about retail operations. Could it all have an adverse effect on their business in the town of Pembroke? That's too much.
Becky, you have one last.
Well, I think it's sort of the same thing you're saying, that I think when we say to gather more data, it's partially not just data about what's known today that we can gather today, but a little more data about the development of who's going to regulate it at the state level and what level of local control is going to be allowed. And I guess my question to you, Chief, would be, what difference does it make if we pass it this May or in the fall?
I think that the state's had time to figure this stuff out, and they haven't.
We have a law without that.
So I don't know what the impact's going to be on Pembroke. I'm not looking to find out. You know, I think that we put it up to the voters. If they want to have retail and commercial sale marijuana, then we'll deal with it. If they don't, then we don't have to deal with it.
Well, you don't really, you can't really say that, though, because we don't know if the state is going to make regulations that are going to make this kind of broad thing more challengeable or not.
So other communities are already preparing for this, and they're already taking similar actions, so it's not like we're the first ones out there. And they're doing it for the same reasons, that they have no idea what the future is going to bring, but they do know what they want to protect and save. And they're doing that, and that's all we're asking you to do.
How many communities have done that?
I think West Bridgewater, in Westboro, and I can come up with some other ones for you.
I mean, do we want to be, I mean, those may be the towns that have to spend the money on the legal fees to fight this out. Do we want to be one of those towns? Why not wait for more information? I still am not hearing anything that tells me that us taking this up at the fall town meeting with a little more data maybe behind us at that point is going to impact the town negatively. If there's going to be no licensing, I mean, definitely not before 2018 and probably not before 2019 based on the current moratorium. So I'm just not hearing anything that says that this has to be pushed through while the state is still making those decisions. I'm just not hearing anything that's going to make a difference.
But I guess I'm not going to convince you.
Well, I was looking for something where, well, if you don't do it this spring, then people are going to gear up to buy property. Or if you don't do it this spring, people are going to be lobbying at the state level. Like, what's going to happen between May and November that's going to impact Pembroke?
You don't think anyone's already lobbying?
I think people are lobbying all over the place. I don't think people are lobbying for Pembroke.
I would just, I would strongly disagree with that. Have you been in Brent's smoke shop? Have you
nope.
been in the Spoken Ashes?
I don't go in there.
Okay. Have you been in the Spoken Ashes shop on Route 139?
No.
And I'll now tell you why. I would say that one half to three quarters of those stores will be different pipes and things that they call tobacco delivery systems. I encourage this board to take a walk through. I inspect these shops. I am speaking from a place of knowledge. If you can walk into either of those two stores and not tell me what their target clientele is, I will now inform you what their clientele is, their target clientele.
Well, yeah, we've had, I mean, sure. Those kind of shops have been around my whole life.
Sure. But if you don't think that those same individuals with a dying cigarette industry and the increasing controls on tobacco are not going to look to augment their businesses with this new possible revenue stream, I think that that is a little short-sighted. We had two tobacco shops open in just the last year targeting specifically this. We have three vape shops. We have two other pre-existing shops of that nature. So I would urge you not to feel safe because you don't think anyone's going to look for a license here. That's the only thing I'm saying.
No, I'm not saying
do or don't do. I'm just saying don't feel comfortable.
No, but Lisa, what's going to happen between May and November?
I don't have a crystal ball.
Well, but there's a moratorium in place at the
sure.
state level.
And when it's lifted...
But is there any indication it's going to be lifted before November?
It depends on who you listen to. Do you listen to The Hill or do you listen to Charlie Baker? They kept promising no more than 1 year to all the people that lobbied for this that are up on Capitol Hill saying, you've stopped our rights. We voted and we got our rights. So I'm sorry in my dealings with the state. No, I don't put 100% faith in any given deadline that can be changed at any time by a vote of a legislator. Seriously, I mean, what would stop the legislature from voting it out sooner? Nothing, as long as the majority voted that way, correct?
No, they don't have the regulations in place, and that's why they pushed it out from correct. 2018 to 2019. Right?
But that could change at any time, too. You agree with me that the vote of the legislature will change that moratorium at any time.
I'd like to see a legislature work more quickly.
No, I also agree with. That I also agree with, but that doesn't mean it can't change.
Yeah, I'm not hearing anything that makes me...
And that's fine, and that's your opinion, and I fully respect this board for those opinions. I guess I'm just more... I subscribe more to the chief's ideas. I would much rather be advanced prepared, pre-prepared, and if we find out we have jumped the gun, by all means, we can repeal it. We don't even have to wait for someone to petition. If we say, oh, we've made a huge mistake...
No, we can't just repeal it.
Yes, with another article,
meeting,
yes, of course.
In the meantime, we could be stuck in litigation.
Sure. But you just said there's a moratorium for a year, so how would we be in litigation before that's over?
But I would argue that this gives us some time to be better prepared and be more prepared for the eventuality that prohibition may be not allowed at some point in time. Which is likely, I think.
Well, you've already played your hand of having some amount of animus, which makes your later reasonable zoning bylaws more challengeable, because you've already put animus out there towards a regulated business. So it could actually put us in a weaker litigation position down the road if it goes that way, I would think.
All right, so we got a motion on the floor. We have a second. Are we ready to vote? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? None. So we will be back on June 12th at 7 p.m.
June 12th at 7 p.m.
Yeah.
Is there?
What do you got, Matthew?
Is there a limit as to how far we can continue a public hearing in the future? I assume there's some sort of, we can't start back here in September, or are there sort of rules about that?
No, we've already taken your option.
I mean, just in general.
Well, I think it depends on what it is. Like, if it's a site plan review that has other time.
That gives the other time for a certain.
Yeah, I think that's the issue. Is that usually we're dealing with something that has an independent time frame that we have to adhere to.
Yeah, but in this case,
what is the end result of tonight? And when it goes before town meeting, we're going to say we don't recommend the article.
No, it won't go no. Before town meeting.
It'll be indefinitely postponed.
Okay.
Absolutely. Okay. Let's see what we got. So I guess start with sort of the easy stuff first. If you guys want to approve the minutes of March 27th.
Approve the meeting minutes of March 27th as written, as printed.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Can I vote given that I arrived halfway through?
Yeah.
Okay.
We still have four, regardless.
Just sort of FYI, this quarterly report of mine, accruing the remaining time is in your packets. Just sort of keeping track of all this.
So you have sick leave separate from leave time? I thought we just had PTO now.
Yes, I have at least in the current contract, the sick leave is separate.
Oh, it is, okay.
I'm not sure what PTO or the rest of it.
Paid time off is where you lump it all together.
Yeah. I don't get sick very often, so I probably don't get most of the sick leave. Occasionally I use it for a doctor's appointment or if I get a coordinated, but, for the most part, it's probably just going to build up and it's worth it. I'll use it occasionally for dentists and doctors, but mainly it'll be like the vacation time is what I'll actually be using it for.
Yeah, the sick leave will be if you break a leg or something.
Don't do that.
Yeah.
I'll break my back more like it. Then this, this thing with the CONCOM meeting, just a note that they actually should nine of these for the different lots. I didn't bother to make photocopies of all of them in the interest of saving paper, but it's actually sort of like nine different, they're all sort of simultaneous, but anyway. It's just for copperwood.
Okay.
And then the other one you can see.
Which one is Carpoint? Do we have a...
That's 40B.
Oh, that's a 40B, okay.
It's currently under construction, I believe.
That's a 40B off of Birch Street?
Yes.
I keep calling it the Birch Street subdivision, but it's not.
Then next is this thing of, I don't know if you guys are all already aware of this, probably some of you have at least kind of heard about it, but they're proposing to create a consolidated Department of Municipal Inspections. This is on the town warrant. It's sort of a proposal to kind of, I guess, sort of revamp and more tightly coordinate how town hall works, or how part of town hall works. And so as I understand it, it would combine the building, I don't see building department here. Anyway, the planning board, board of health, CONCOM, and the ZBA, I thought it also applied to the building department too. Anyway, sort of combining them all to have like sort of, I guess, sort of unified filing, better coordination. And so it would sort of, I guess it would sort of kind of adjust the way in which potentially I would work, or sort of the way it would all be organized.
Would we have a town planner then?
Well, apparently that's in there just because, it says town planner, but that's just because they're taking this from what Hanover did. They're taking this sort of this terminology. So I don't think it means, or I was told it doesn't mean they're going to immediately create a town planner. I mean, in the long run, I suppose it's potentially the case. Apparently they're talking about moving the Board of Health down to where the planning office currently is, and moving planning up to where the second floor somewhere. So yeah, it's I mean, it, this is sort of long term. What?
Who put this forward?
Is this coming from the advisory?
It's coming from advisory or the Board of Selectmen. It says submitted by the town government study committee.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's right. Yeah. I mean, I got the
sense. I guess we should have been in on some of these meetings. Did we have someone on that meeting?
I was on it for a while.
Oh, you were?
Yeah.
Yes. I think it's something that the selectmen, or I got the sense the selectmen are more or less on board, although I could be wrong. I think it's something that several other towns have done. I mean, whether that's or not, I don't know.
It's basically for the planner under the town administrator.
It's up there with the planning system. But this is contingent on there being a director of municipal inspections who shall be a town administrator or appointed by the town administrator, subject to approval by the Board of Selectmen. So the town administrator can act as the director of municipal inspections or appoint someone to that.
And apparently, at least in the near future, their intention is that it would be the town administrator who would be the director.
So the town administrator becomes in charge of the planner, which we don't have, who then has final decisions made by the planning board, but no one's really come in to talk to us about how that would work.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely some, I mean, that's why when I found out about it, I thought, well, you guys should know about this. I mean, there's some ambiguity there. Then again, there's I suppose there's currently some ambiguities also.
I guess this is a require a public hearing. The
planning board assistant committee? We should.
It's not defined here.
Yeah, that's what I was curious about.
we had tried to get a town planner.
Yeah.
In place of a town planning board assistant, and that was rejected by the powers that be in terms of funding. So we hired someone, namely you, with some abilities and capabilities that bridge multiple functions to try to give us a little bit more ability to do some work with some planner and try to move towards a town planner position. So it is interesting that they would have met with us in the spring once to talk about that position and tell us what happened to that position, that it would be an administrative position, not a town planner position, and then put this forward without coming back to talk to us about the impact on the functioning of our board. So it's concerning to me.
there's no one here to talk to us about this.
No, I just saw this and I thought, my board should be aware of this.
Yes, thank you.
I mean, definitely, they should have talked to you about it. I don't know if they intentioned that, but I think, you know, I was told that, I mean, naturally, I was sort of curious as well, understand? So I was told that there's no plan, like in the immediate future, there's no plan to sort of create a town planner, either by adding it to me or replacing me or making it or anything like that. Like, that's not sort of an immediate plan, because you'd have to go to town meeting even to create a new category.
I mean, this,
but in the long run, who knows?
This may be a good idea, but to me right now, it looks like a solution in search of a problem. I don't know what the problem is. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I do think, quite honestly, that, you know, I've advocated that we have some meetings between the planning board and the CBA to talk about the ways in which we work together and coordinate our roles. And it could be that this person would help in that process. But I am concerned that the planning board at this point is an independently elected board. Now would have a town planner that reports to someone who can be removed by the Board of Selectmen, which seems to take the independence of the planning board function away to some extent.
But on the other hand, there could be some value to that, mm-hmm. in that they're not strictly under the planning board's auspices, which means they may get, you know, have the opportunity to get other information on a regular basis that from a single source, you know what I'm saying? That may concern some other issues in town, say right. ZBA or like inspectional services, things like that.
Kind of interesting too, that I'm just reading here, like the Board of Health, that the health agent would report to the Director of Municipal Inspections, which is the town administrator. So there may be more to this than just trying to clean things up. Conservation agent would also report to the town administrator. So I think what they're doing is basically making these non-independent.
Well, it may streamline things a bit.
Okay.
And make it clearer. And make it a little easier on the boards to deal with, zoning issues and the issues before them instead of, policy issues with employers.
Well, and also all of these boards are elected boards that are, basically volunteer boards that aren't in the building every,
Right, right.
5 days a week.
And then you'd have someone in the building 5 days a week who would...
could deal with snow.
Right.
It's a little bit weird because it says that essentially when performing inspectional services, they'll be subject to the administrative control of the Director of Municipal Inspections, but not otherwise. Does our town planner actually perform any inspectional services like the Board of Health agent inspects for Title V? The zoning enforcement officer actually goes out and inspects properties and inspects, does the town planner actually do inspections of any kind?
No, the inspections are done by the planning board's engineer. Not by the town planner and not by nothing.
Right. So I'm not sure how this works with respect to us.
Well, that may be an inspection that's not defined here. Right. So I think that's included here. They may have
that very well maybe
overlooked that or didn't take that into consideration.
All right, so what do we want to do? We're just be knowledgeable.
Yeah, I guess just be aware of it. It will be on the warrant for the spring meeting.
Do we have time for someone to come in and explain this to us and talk to us about it? And I mean, we've got this in front of us now. We can develop a list of questions.
You can ask the Director of Municipal Inspection.
There isn't one yet.
Or the town administrator.
Not yet. Maybe if this goes through, that would be the case. But
maybe we can.
But I suppose it could ask.
I don't think he would come in, but maybe we could ask Sabrina or somebody to come in.
Well, there are people who sat on this
right.
government study committee who are probably very interested in getting this passed and getting some buy-in for it. So I think they'd want to come before us and explain some stuff to us.
All right, should we get it on? What do we have on next week's agenda?
Next week.
We're done.
Next 2 weeks, I'll be in France.
We can also have some for this week. get together for an hour, just a couple of members of the board, just to get an overview of it.
So we don't necessarily have to do it, yeah.
If we make us feel more comfortable about it, I think it would be helpful to find a bit more.
Do you want to maybe hit up Dan Trabuco or? I don't know who's of interest. I know Becky will just take on anything. I mean, I'd be interested in sitting on that. All right, so what?
If we got more than four of us, or if, you know, do we want, I don't know if we want to post a meeting or just have an informational gathering.
Can we do it at our next meeting? Or a meeting, and if, well, you're away.
We have a couple meetings before town meeting.
Yeah, you've got April 24th, May 1st, May 8th.
Okay, yeah.
So my only question is whether we're more likely to get a meeting with the town administrator if it's not conflicting with one of the other meetings.
No, we're not looking to meet with the town administrator. We're looking to meet with one of the representatives from the Governance Study Committee.
Oh, okay.
Who's drafted this.
Do we know who's on that?
Yeah, Dan Trabuco.
Tim Brennan was on that.
Yeah.
You may want to get Tim Brennan in the talk to us.
I don't have contact information for him. I know Dan.
I guess if you guys decide you do want to be as a planning board meeting, then just let me know. But yeah, it might be easier to schedule with some of these folks, especially Dan Trabuco, if you do it at a different day and time.
I can reach out to Tim if you want.
I think he's the chair of it.
Yeah. Well, he also wrote a letter to the editor this past week in regards to supporting this. So.
Oh, did he?
Yeah.
Okay, I missed that.
In America.
Oh.
So what are those dates? Just quickly, Matthew, you may be available for 15 minutes.
You mean our future board
meetings? Yeah, our future meetings.
April 24th. So I was just going to mention, as I said before, so I'll be gone basically next week, April 8th to April 17th. And then I come back on Tuesday. Town hall's closed on Monday at the Civic Center. So April 24th, May 1st, and May 8th. And then, of course, you know, after town meeting with them. But those
and
are the
what do the agendas look like on the 24th, 1st, and 8th? Do we have a lot done that?
The 24th, 220 Center Street, the continuation is at 7 o'clock. Bristol Estates, I guess, to actually vote to approve it and to write up the conditions. I think we've got tentatively for the 24th. We had Bruce Hughes, the economic development guy.
Yes.
I'm thinking we should probably maybe push that back to an hour. We can really give him a full, the 24th is really getting kind of crowded. Like maybe he should be like a first or third Monday in June or something where we could really give him a full letter.
So what's the first
one? That makes sense.
May 1st at the moment is just, we attentively discussed having the public hearing for the proposed zoning bylaws for the Center Protection District. So right now that's the only thing for May 1st, and then May 8th we discussed having the public hearing for Brian Murphy's project on Oak Street.
We could probably fit it on May 1st if we've got nothing other than that public hearing.
Yeah, I would think so.
Sure. Why don't we do that?
You want to pencil on 8 p.m. for that discussion, and we'll see if he's available. He's going to be available.
Yeah.
We'll see if that's the case.
I'm not sure how it is with you guys. We go a little earlier. But I'm okay. 8 sounds good.
Okay, so 8 o'clock on my first discussion of Department of Municipal Instructions. Okay, so then for Bryson Way extension, the letters from Peter. So it seems as though sort of Brian Taylor has gotten the stuff that and so they're sort of in good shape on that. There are the two things that Peter, as you can see on the sort of the first sheet here, the two items that Peter thinks should be in the conditions. But it sounds like we're good to go for Bryson Way extension. I had already previously been working on like writing up the decision and the conditions for that, so maybe I should try to finish that and maybe have it ready for you guys to look at on April 24th. I was hoping to get it done tonight, but I couldn't get it done by this meeting. Or I could email it to you guys perhaps, but it seems as though we're ready to just sort of go ahead and sort of do the decision and submit it to the town clerk.
Sounds good.
Can we close the public hearing for that?
Yeah.
Yes.
But we still have to make a motion to accept the subdivision. Approve the subdivision.
I think we just closed the hearing. I don't think we did it.
We have no conditions.
I think you guys did vote to approve it, I think, at the public hearing, but you didn't do conditions or... anyway, so I'll work on that.
What else you got there?
Let's see. So for this, the last figure is for this fellow coming at 7:30 for this Form A again. Or I'm sorry, 8:30 I think it is.
Yep.
What?
Dr. Townsend.
Yeah, yeah. So just quickly, a few more things too. I think we've got a few more minutes here. What else have I got for you folks? For the proposed or for the discussions these guys had about the takeout restaurant in town center, the Chinese takeout that they were talking
yeah.
about. So that would be a special permit. I just wanted to check with you folks. Would we need to do, and I think the answer is probably no, like a full site plan review process or something like that. I mean, it's a laundromat, I suppose. I come in, I guess sort of technically it's a change of use, but it's not really something I would think you'd want to do a site plan review.
We need to do anything
with that. Not unless we're doing anything with the structure.
Which I highly doubt.
What is the Center Protection District, Karen?
For signage?
No, isn't the one where it's under the special permit, we're going to conduct a hearing one way or the other, so how do you want to call it? We have to conduct a special permit hearing because the applicant is seeking essentially takeout business where we prohibited that.
Right.
Okay. So there is a public hearing required. Required. Are you asking to have some site plan or is that some special permit?
Yeah, I mean, I think I understand they'll need the public hearing for special permit and the application. Do we want to have them all? Bless you.
Well, we get bird flu.
Do we want to have them also, in addition to the special permit, also do have to do a full sort of site plan? I think the answer is probably. I mean, even with that one and that medical thing, Chris, I'm sure you guys voted to exempt them from it, so to speak. I mean, even if it was, and so I think in this case, even if it were necessary.
So this would require a public hearing for a special permit under the...
Because it's a restaurant.
Under the Center Protection District.
I think any restaurant, I believe, right? So
all restaurants. Require a special permit.
But no site plan. No site plan application necessary.
Center Protection District vis-a-vis a special permit.
Yeah. All right, that makes things a little easier, I think.
All right, what else, Matthew? We've got to start this moving on here.
Yeah, sorry, just a sec. Okay, so for Bruce Hughes, I guess I'll talk to him and talk about pushing it back into May or June. As soon as possible, I think.
Good.
Would it be okay if it would be a first or third Monday?
Yeah.
I think that would help. Otherwise, it's going to be hard to find the adequate time. Really. And we'll do that after town meeting.
Okay, that's not good.
I think that's about it. For the public hearing, the Oak Street, the Brian Murphy project, the public hearing on May 8th, for me to do the legal ad, I guess we need to set a time. I assume 7 o'clock would be okay. I guess that would be the night before town meeting. Would 7 o'clock be fine for that?
Yeah, but you have nothing else on there.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, we're going to move on.
Sorry, just one more thing, too. For 590 Washington, can we, the old Non-Go project, can we return his positive engineering review balance to him?
Which one is that?
The side of the condos.
Next to Darius.
Next to
Darius.
They're not done yet, though.
They're done. I believe he's selling them.
There's no wind.
Do we have a final?
How much money is that?
$1,000.
Let's leave it for now.
Yeah. There's no landscaping in there. I think of a plan they had talked about, put in buffer zones and stuff like that.
Has he made a request yet?
He's requested it sort of informally. He hasn't officially given us a letter. The last invoice was about slightly more than a year. The last invoice from Merrill was about a year.
Project isn't.
Why would we do the actual project site?
Okay, see if that's not correct.
I don't know, not to me.
Okay, I think
okay, all right. Hi.
So this is Debbie Cena.
Oh, hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm well, thanks. Thank you for your time. My name is Debbie Cena. I'm a realtor with Cobble Banker, and I represent the listings on Adepisa Street, 19 and 19A. They're condoized, it's a 1.87-acre property. It's directly across from Stop and Shop and CVS. I don't know if you're all familiar with. And my reason for coming tonight, I've had a couple specific inquiries, but I've asked the owner's permission for myself to come. It's mainly just to get a better understanding as to maybe what the town would allow or not allow for business use for that property. I had 4 specific questions, and it's just to gain knowledge, so not to ask for, you know, something very definitive. But
And just to clarify one thing. She's now representing the entire, like it's no longer just the back part, but now it's the whole.
Both owners.
Both buildings, like it's one parcel. So now they've got the frontage, just like the both buildings that now she's.
The 2 separate owners, but it's condoized. So they're both in agreement with trying to sell it as one unit if possible. So I guess I had couple of inquiries. Someone had asked, would the town allow like residential condos? Someone else asked me, would they allow elderly housing units, a fast food restaurant? And then one of the owners, the other inquiry was, I know it's a Central Protection District, and I realize that there's a vision for that. One of the owners wanted to know from the town, what is the vision, what would be the ideal type of business that you would like to see on that property? And I said, well, I don't know that, but I'll inquire. So those are the 3 kind of inquiries I've had, and just for myself. And I've had a couple informals with Matthew, and he's been great with, you know, making me understand the zoning and the Central Protection District and the layers to the property, but it's really just for my marketing purposes, so I can maybe answer some questions to these kinds of questions.
Let's look at the bylaw. I don't know,
Chairman.
As it stands right now, it's a condominium.
He is.
Two businesses, two...
Two owners.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are they thinking about making it residential?
At one point, the front building was a residence. So I guess it depends who were to buy it, is that correct? If they, if someone were to buy it and want to operate the front home and, or bought the entire parcel and had their business out back and their home in the front? It's like a colonial structure.
Yeah, is that where the landscaping, the installation?
Yes, you can do us.
He's no longer on, he hasn't, you know, since I've had the listing, hasn't completed any acres with me. So there's no, I don't have any, like, certain party that's come forward. These are just kind of questions the builder asked me about the residential housing. Some other gentleman was asking me about, you know, elderly housing units. And I assume they may take down the two parcels and start over. Is that something the town would even allow?
We don't have a prohibition in the district to remove our buildings. They would just have to meet the rest of the standards of the bylaw.
Okay.
There are uses about it, which are the uses in 7A. And those are uses that are allowed, sort of, you know, there's site plan reviews to make sure that they don't, but then any other rules, but as a use, permitted use or allows them right. There is nothing in the bylaw that would allow strict residential multifamily by itself.
No.
That's not in the bylaw, it's not contemplated for that specific district. The multifamily use that's contemplated by the bylaw, which is what we have to go by, requires a special permit from this board to look at the project. And it has to be a mix of commercial and residential if it's going to be multifamily.
Okay.
Restaurants are permitted by special permit as well, you know, assuming they go through Board of Health and everyone else. But the bylaw does not allow strictly drive-through establishment. But what that means, we could probably have discussion about. And there are restrictions as to the type of building and the type of architecture that would have to be there. But, you know, we try to look at the bylaws as much as possible and say, okay, does it fit within the spirit and the intent of the bylaws? So I would say that strictly multifamily residential doesn't fit within the bylaw.
Okay.
A mixed use where it's residential and commercial could fit, but it would require a special permit, so that's nothing we could opine on. But I think you'd want to be careful opining on that.
I think that property is also too small for mixed use, at least as I read about and what
is it, when you looked at the rest of the rules, it wouldn't fit there?
Well, I think so, yeah, when she talked about
frontage and square footage may be a challenge.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not familiar enough with that.
How big is a lot?
It's a 1.87 acre.
And how wide?
I think it's 142 feet of frontage.
Okay.
I think it's 150.
Okay.
So
too high.
Makes it hard. With an easement, you know, going around to the back. So
mixed uses. You're supposed to have 250 square feet. So that would probably be a challenge, would require some relief from the zoning bylaw, which
that's a lot of relief.
If they kept the exact structures that are there,
could they do mixed use?
Could they do mixed use? I guess that would be.
Less than 2 acres, 100 square foot.
Yeah.
Right. And it hasn't been mixed use. I mean, if you have a residential and a business use, but then you just need to be the residential use, you sort of lose the grandfather of that use.
But for other things, if the frontage is 142 feet, then at least you're pretty close to the 150-foot requirement for the other.
It's also grandfathered. Built. Basically, offices, professional space, medical spaces, the whole list of things that you have a lot of use.
Right.
So you can get any of those.
Okay.
Would it, as far as a restaurant dimension or something, that requires a special permit.
Right.
That would be issued by this board. But I recall you see that back building. I'm not sure. Yeah, the restaurant.
Like a McDonald's or a Wendy's or something like that?
Yeah, we don't have anything in our bylaws that says Wendy's prohibited.
Okay.
Okay?
No, are
nor McDonald's, nor
okay.
Panera Bread, Taco Bell. We don't list anybody else in the city. So. But the bigger the restaurant, the more the traffic. The more the traffic, the more the concern.
Right. Okay. And any vision or ideal? I know. That was one of the owner's questions.
I don't have a preconceived notion of what would be good or bad for the district. I think, you know, the bylaw sort of speaks for itself in that it's sort of encouraging business development in that town center.
Mm-hmm.
And within that range, I don't have a preference for one business over another.
Okay.
Or for one application over another.
Would some form of the auto care be allowed?
What, auto care?
Auto care?
No. Only outpatient. Not the services. Elderly care. Right.
So just one other question, so I'm clear. So that two buildings, the front building, if someone were to buy both parcels and wanted to operate their home in the front and have their business in the back, is that considered mixed use? No. It would be.
We allow in-home businesses in town.
So it could be a residency.
In-home businesses we allow in town.
So part of the office was in there, and then they had, I don't know, the warehouse or whatever type of business.
That's not an in-home business any longer. That's why I point out the exact term, in-home.
Okay.
Not detached, away from, and about, and around the area. In-home business. So if you had a dentist who owned a single-family home, who wanted to then practice his dental practice in that home,
right.
Allowable.
Okay.
When you take the dentist who owns the home up front and says, I want to open a clinic out back somewhere,
right. That's
an entirely different matter now.
Okay.
Not in-home businesses any longer, and that's the problem.
So. The really only way to go about that would be if two different parties were to buy the both buildings and one operated it.
One operated it, say a residency home, and somebody did something else in the back.
Okay. All right. Just like that understanding.
Awesome.
Well, that's an interesting question because when you conduit, you don't change the use. You change the ownership. That's the reason why you need permission for conduits.
Well, I indicated last time, I think this came before us, is that you have a problem because I was unaware that it's condoized. I don't know why owners of the property would have done that.
You'd
be able to answer better than I, but...
Well, I can because I conduit my own property in Hanson, my own commercial property in Hanson, and there's a state law that permits ownership through a condo association, but it does not change any of the use restrictions on the property by virtue of being as condos. So the site plan review, the use restrictions, the use permits, all remain the same.
As they are today.
As they would be without the condo.
And it's still one parcel, and when you look at the assessment,
so it's still one parcel. So I don't think having, they have different interests, I guess. No, but having two owners would not allow them to have, the property as a whole needs to comply with the use restrictions.
I see.
The condo association as a whole needs to comply with the use restrictions. All you do through the condo process is change the ownership, not the use of the property.
And it can't really be divided, because then you wouldn't have frontage in the back.
Yeah, that was the problem I saw before, and I found out they were being sold separately, I said, well, who's lacking frontage?
The condo association, the parcel as a whole, has the frontage, and has the site plan, has the use restrictions. And the ownership into two separate units is strictly for ownership purposes. And that's under a state law that allows that ownership.
Yeah.
A condo form of ownership.
That's what happened at the real estate office down on Center Street.
Yeah.
They condoized that years ago. The house always remains single family residence and a flower shop.
They didn't change, yeah, they didn't change the usage.
Right.
Well, thank you very much for your time, appreciate it. Thank you, Matthew.
All right. Looks like you're back, sir. How are you? Ready to rest? You ready? Oh, yeah. Hey, Bobby.
Okay, for the record, my name is Steve Kotowski, Webby Engineering. Most of you were here the last time I was here back in January. I had come in before the board asking before they consider endorsing an A&R plan for the adding on of some additional backland onto some existing lots that my client owns. My client owns these two Form A lots and then all this land all the way back to High Street. What we were trying to do back then was just to add this parcel on in the back that would, so we were going to add this piece in the back and then try to provide access coming in from the existing right-of-way that he still maintains, that this house actually has a driveway over as well. So we had come in a couple different times with a couple different scenarios to try to do that, and ultimately the board felt that after getting an opinion from town council that they couldn't endorse the Form A application. So my client still wanted to try to develop the property. I kind of mentioned to the board that he had a couple of options, none of which were options that he really wanted to kind of pursue, but there were options that, you know, was limited options that he had, which required us to go back to the Conservation Commission. So as I said, he owns these two lots as Form A lots, and he owns all the land in the back. And we went before the Conservation Commission a couple of weeks ago with a plan to create accessway, because the reason it seemed that this board wasn't in favor of the other accessway proposal was is that the plan presented gave the impression of having illusionary frontage, that, you know, we had access to the frontage here, but we were accessing our property over here. And there was a couple of cases that town council had mentioned, one of which, as I was trying to kind of emphasize, was that it's they used the term better or more manageable if there was another location or a better option for access. Again, the board, you felt that it was still, we hadn't met the requirement, or we hadn't, and that the way it was proposed was creating illusionary frontage here and accessing it here. So again, the only two options that we had left us was originally we had filed with Conservation to build a small house here, and actually we were building, proposing two houses, one on each one of the lots. They were real tight. The Conservation Commission really didn't like it. We were denied a order of conditions to do that. We tried to get a superseding order of conditions through the state, and they didn't approve our superseding order of conditions, basically because we had combined the lots. That wasn't the way it was originally proposed, and we hadn't gone and gone through the process of getting our Board of Health approval. So again, we came back to you after that. So when after the Planning Board had decided not to endorse the A&R plan, went back to my client to sit down and try to figure out what were the other options, and so we thought we could try this again and go through the process of filing a notice of intent, doing what we had intended to do on this, knowing that the Conservation Commission wasn't crazy about that because it really was really a tight yard, there wasn't a lot of room in there. And also it just was kind of a crummy location for a house. The second option that we had is we're allowed to do a filling of wetlands to create access to this back portion of land. That's what's illustrated or highlighted in yellow, which is what we were proposing. This is the plan that I presented to the Conservation Commission a couple weeks ago. And granted, it's not obviously what my client wants to do, and it's just sort of what, you know, he felt that he had left as available options. So we were filling just under 5,000 square feet of bordering vegetated wetlands, replicating down in this area. Made the presentation, the board had some additional comments and some concerns relative to the way it was presented. And so I had a punch list of a few items that we were gonna, you know, take back to the drawing board and come back before the Conservation Commission. And at the end of the discussion, some of the board members, including Mr. Clark, who's here tonight, had said, well, I prefer that, you know, you have another option over here. This was the option that we kind of had available. He said, you know, I'm not going to speak to him because he's here tonight, but my feeling was is that he said, you know, we should try to come back before the Planning Board to see if you'll reconsider it. I do think that because we've kind of filled in a couple of the gaps from what town council's reason maybe that you didn't endorse the A&R plan originally was just because we were just kind of presenting it in a hearsay, you know, this is what we can do, this is what we could do, but we hadn't really gone through the process of presenting it. We didn't have this plan to kind of show you what would be our additional option. So the way I'm kind of presenting it tonight is I think I'd like you to consider again the second case that town council had pointed out when they said that you can endorse A&R if the applicant is to present a plan, which, you know, I think the first one, that the case that was here, they voted to not provide A&R endorsement because it was, again, more hearsay. The applicant in that case had said, I'd have to fill in 2,000 feet of driveway, remove a guardrail, but it seemed that the case that they were referring to, that there was no demonstration that those were the facts. And so that case seemed like it was just, you have illusionary frontage, you can't access the land. The additional case, I think, was where we were hoping you would consider is that where there were two options available, this being the first option that we are presenting before the commission and before you, is one option. This is, you know, something that we can continue to try to work on and hopefully get through the Conservation Commission and satisfy their concerns and, you know, ultimately get a permit.
But you haven't told us that you've satisfied anybody's concerns that would make that real access.
Well, we did present this to them. The concerns that they had were just additional information, but I think that it is within our right to fill in the wetlands and to cross through and replicate. It's,
you know, so are you asking us to approve that as an A&R plan?
Asking you to consider it. It was, again, it was at the end of the night, the commission, along with Mr. Clark, had said, prefer for us to come back before you folks. And I said, okay, I have no problem with that. And he volunteered to come here this evening and speak on
But what you haven't talked about are our real concerns.
Okay.
Right? Our real concerns were that this is bypassing the rules about no shared driveways. Because although the driveways would be together, they couldn't safely be separated. And secondly, are you going to put a fence down that whole driveway, and then is that going to make it safe for cars to go two ways?
Well, again, on both of those points, I thought I had addressed that at the last time. We revised the plan, if you remember, so that you have a 50-foot wide portion of land that my client owns. It's not a right-of-way, it's actually his land that goes down to Valley Street.
The people that live in this house have the right to a 20-foot wide strip that comes here and goes down through there, and that's what they're limited to. And their driveway is located here. It's shown, went out there and located it to show it accurately on the plan. The yellow would be shown on the opposite side of that. So you have a 50-foot wide access. We've actually given them a little bit more room.
What's the separation between the two?
It's about 9 feet now. I didn't know what it was at the time. I think I was throwing up 4 or 5 feet, but we could make it as much as 9 feet wide between the two driveways.
Steve, wasn't the intent of that 50-foot right of way for a road to walk back?
It originally, when these lots were created, there was an access way here and an access way there, and it was to provide access to his land in Duxbury.
And is he preserving an easement on both of these people's proposed properties to get access to the back there? And if so, weren't you just building a road that can be used down the road?
He's not reserving an easement because he's not deeding this parcel to anybody, so he still maintains ownership of the land.
He's just getting an easement. He's owning the road? I thought the road was going to go with the property.
No, it's not being conveyed. No. He's just going to provide another easement over his own land.
So he can still develop that as a road, as long as they have access?
He could, sure.
And why? What happened? The other suggestion we had is, if he has the land right there, why not design it as a little mini road with a cul-de-sac?
Again, it's a matter of just, this is really the last piece of land that he has that he can develop in the town of Pembroke. Anything that comes over here in Duxbury, we've already been before Duxbury, and they've said, number one, they have a 650-foot dead-end road, similar to a lot of towns. Once you get to this point, you're at 215, you're probably another 200 feet. There's really only enough room there if you were to develop any land in Duxbury to get maybe one or two lots, and it just wasn't, you know, economically a good idea to just create a road to make one or two lots. And then the other thing was, is Duxbury said they just didn't want to have a road coming in from Pembroke and, you know, have to, you know, go through all the complications of.
So these houses will not have frontage through their driveways. That will only be an easement for their driveways.
Correct. The frontage for this lot was over here. Again, it was similar as far as what we were proposing. That we were proposing to
build, except they had very little wetlands.
Yeah, we had to cross over here. So we were going through the same process, filed with the Conservation Commission. They didn't like it. They sent us to you folks, and that's how we came up with this through a Form A process. So when we came back to you folks, we figured this is similar, yes, a little bit lengthier of a driveway that we're proposing, but again, trying to address the common drive issue by creating two separate driveways side by side is we've cut an easement on the other side of this for the benefit, and it's labeled, you know, this is the existing access and utility easement that's deeded for this house. The other one that's over here would be exclusive for this house, so they would have two separate driveways, so that would solve the common drive concern as far as.
And what about access for public safety vehicles?
Well, again, I've been out here. I think maybe Mr. Clark can say, because I mentioned it at the commission meeting the other night, but the access coming in here, it seems very adequate to me. I mean, it seems like a nice driveway up there to the back to that house, and this one would be actually a little bit closer.
So we've been kind of talking last time about doing a cul-de-sac thing, but you went back to conservation with that other plan?
Right, well, that's what his options were to, again, this was one
option. So he thinks this would be less expensive than doing a little cul-de-sac?
Sure, yeah.
Really?
You mean as far as to
filling in all of that, and the wetlands would be cheaper than doing a little cul-de-sac?
I believe so, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of other factors as far as, well, again, we had gotten into the discussion as far as, you know, if you were to use just sort of a generic $300 per square foot to build a road with a cul-de-sac and everything else, you'd be talking with building this road, say, you know, 300 feet, that's $100,000 to build a road under today's requirements. And that's not considering your permitting fees, your engineering review fees,
the probably 6 months that it takes to go through that process. That's why when we talked about that, I was kind of throwing that idea throughout this commission, I mean the board, would you be interested in waiving some of your lines to bring that cost down? And everybody just kind of looked at me and said, no. You know, we're not at that point where we're gonna talk about that. So
what's your estimate on the cost to fill in the wetlands? And
well, that's kind of one of the things is you have this material coming up. The road's only gonna be about a foot higher than the existing grade.
Mm-hmm.
There's a few pipes that are going in there. It's gravel. I mean, a lot of the material they'll be able to take off here because they have to dig this area out. So most of that work's gonna be done on site. Some of this loam will be brought back in here to reestablish that area. So I'm not saying it's going to be an even swap, but it's probably going to be $10,000, $15,000 worth of material and labor to build this section of driveway. Maybe another five to replicate the wetlands. So you're talking maybe $20,000 as opposed to close to $100,000. By the time you'd be done building this road to service one more lot, there's really no profit in, you know, for anybody to do that.
Steve, how many feet of road do you have going that way?
For the driveway or for the road?
For the roadway, for the driveway.
The driveway's over 700.
700?
It's 300 and something feet within the wetlands.
You're going to put it in, it's 12 feet wide.
The one to the right isn't the road, it's two driveways.
Yeah, that one was 400 feet, basically. So it's another 300 feet of driveway, more or less, there.
Where is the water service going to be and the electric going to be for that second line?
Not ironically, but they had a little bit of forethought. There was a service that was out here and another service, and when they tried to figure out which ones they were because they left one for a potential roadway, they ran the water service in on this lot. So there's a service right here already. And there's a pole there and everything's there before if they were to develop that location.
Personally, Steve, if I was to live 350, 400 feet off of Valley Street, I would love to see a hydrant reasonably close to me. I think you should build the road.
My client doesn't want to build the road. I think, you know, it seems a bit extreme to build a road for one additional lot. Especially, and again, this is his way of looking at it. He has frontage on Valley Street already. To create the road, you'd be using the road to create the additional frontage, where he has two lots worth of frontage down here. That's the way he sees it. He's had these lots since 1977. He's always thought, you know, somewhere down the road he'd be able to develop them. He feels that he's been sort of, you know, I wouldn't say mistreated, but where we had filed for these and the wetlands lines have creeped over the years, whereas before they went back a little bit further. Again, those were just his ways of looking at it as far as, you know, trying to, you know, creating these lots, paying taxes on them for all these years. It's even for me to try to convince him you've got maybe one more lot here, he still looks at it as having, I've got two lots, I get two tax bills. And that's just the way he sees it, you know.
Now the water service is a separate line.
It's optional.
The first line, correct?
It's a separate easement. So you have already one that's existing.
I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
But you ran the two water services basically a couple of feet off of each other.
Yeah, they're pretty much lined up on the side of the driveway.
Right. So
they're already in.
So that
yeah, because
service,
this one already has its water,
water
and that one's just dead.
On
thank you, sir.
For the first house,
there is no real additional easement. They have the right to basically use all of this land wherever it exists. The new easement line would separate that.
Wait a minute. So the first house already has a right to use the entire land,
the driveway that's out there now, and everything out to.
Well, but he has a right then, from what you're saying, to use the entire driveway. If you've already granted that you're telling us that you're going to separate the driveways, but your owner has already sold to the first house an easement that includes the whole 50 feet, so you have no right to separate those driveways.
I didn't create it. All I know is that when we ran it by him, it was he said, let's just separate it in half once
yeah,
we
locate
the driveways.
Yeah, but what easement is already owned by the first owner?
It's a prescriptive easement that says that they have the right to use the driveway over his land. That's, as far as I know,
that's all the easement says?
I'm pretty sure. There is no boundary within it, as far as there's no plan that shows a defined easement.
Plan? The A&R plan.
That plan didn't have an easement on it. It just had this lot and this lot. It didn't have an easement on it because we weren't proposing to cut it in half, and that's just the action.
Right. My question was whether that A&R plan shows it with all 50 feet being available to that lot.
I don't have the plan in front of me, so I don't know.
Steve, how wide is the existing driveway?
It's this one on this lot,
yeah.
About 12 feet.
And it's all on the left side?
Yeah, it was gravel when we were kind of starting this process, and then they went and paved it, so it's
right,
okay.
It looks like it's in the middle of the easement, but I'm not going to
say. No, it doesn't. We actually hooked it right along this back property line and right along that sideline.
Right.
Yeah.
But you think they might have paved up the middle?
It looks like it could be.
No, there's actually, if you did go out there, you'd see that we set an iron rod here. There's a bound here, and it's about, like it shows, about 5 feet off that. It comes real close to that corner, just mm-hmm. the way it's shown on this plan. So there's about a 5, maybe 7 or 8 foot buffer between this property and the edge of the driveway.
I got a funny feeling it's going to be one paved, wide driveway when they're done.
They
go back into the fire truck around that corner. You get two separate individual drivers.
We hear from Bob Clark since they brought
Mr. Clark.
Steve has presented his side. And my board have a problem with what he's proposed to us. Again, the fire truck can't make that 90-degree bend on that driveway, no matter what it does. So the whole driveway needs to be re-engineered somehow to make that corner so that it can do it.
This 90-degree one or the other one?
They're both pretty much the same.
Except this is in wetland. The other one is up in a nice ground. This is, if you come off of the 8 foot of driveway that's up there.
Are you really in bad wetlands?
Yeah. It's all, and I believe that if their figures are right, I haven't seen them for lengths and all, but they're right at the edge of 5,000 square feet of fill of driveway. Mm-hmm. And that's what the law or regulations allow. If they have to do anything at the corner or anywhere else, they're going to go over the 5. That triggers another whole different setup for conservation. I just can't see that what he's proposed is even buildable. But we haven't had discussions that far, other than the board knows that they don't like it. The fire chief looked at it and said there just was no way that he could bring a truck around what was designed on that plan.
So Concom would not allow this, then, is more or less what you're saying.
What?
I mean, it sounds like you're saying Concom and the fire chief would not allow this.
Right now, they couldn't approve it the way it is. It's not feasible.
Well, again, I don't know if Concom can make a determination. I mean, if my client owns land and he says I want to fill in and replicate, and it's, they're allowed to do up to 5,000 square feet. We're not filing this, even though the activity is a proposed driveway. Again, it's his land to be able to do that. And so, you know, I think they're two separate issues as far as the fire department is concerned. I don't know how the Conservation Commission can say, well, the fire department says this, and so we're not going to allow it. I don't know if that's a legitimate argument that they can make.
It's one we can make.
Right. It is one that you could make.
I mean, it still
looks
so illusory.
So we'll take your suggestion.
No, but I mean, if that's the driveway you present, it still appears to be an illusory access because you haven't adequately provided for public safety.
And again, we do have other options, again, that we would go back to when, you know, we can fill more wetlands and file under the Army Corps permitting process. And, you know, if we had to add more width or add a little bit sharper corner or anything like that, again, the point is that I think that we can negotiate through the Conservation Commission to ultimately permit something that they don't want and we don't want.
Or you can take something that we don't want. I mean, I
well,
sort of feel
again,
like...
I think we go back to the whole thing, which is that, you know, we think that the way that it presented or was presented a few months ago is
this
that it's... Exactly. Not
which one
this
are you trying to get through?
Obviously the one that we don't have to cross through the wetlands.
Yeah.
So what we're trying to do is demonstrate that, yes, we could do that, whether it's with the plan that we have in front of the Conservation Commission now, or, okay, maybe... The fire department isn't crazy about it. We take that into consideration and we widen it, and then we go through a limited project. And again, then we have to file with the Army Corps and make this wider and more accessible and fill in more wetlands and replicate more wetlands and go through that. So ultimately, we satisfy everybody on this side of the room, and then, you know.
Yeah, you got way more barriers to getting this one done than you do the flip side of this, I think. You know, the conservation's not with you on this, and we'd have the public safety concerns. Well, Tom, what's your big issue with the two separate driveways that you think they'd end up as one?
Well, I think it's going to end up as one.
But he doesn't want to spend the money on the road, so
no,
why would he fill in between two?
Well, I think what's going to happen is they're going to end up butting the two.
Well, why would they do that if he's opposed to putting in a road?
Well,
because what
do you
do? Lay out road.
I would like the fire chief to look at that plan and say there's two separate roads going up there with a barrier between them. What's going to happen when I try to put my fire truck in there?
What's going to happen when you try to go home and someone's coming out?
What's going to happen when everybody in town has got a similar lot just comes in with the same plan?
Right.
Eliminates frontage requirement, provides access to the land, not on land they own. And in this case, is a bold attempt to just cross over wetlands. Where?
I'm sorry?
Where would we allow that to occur anywhere else? I mean, you've been here three times before, so represent this client.
Yep.
And we wouldn't allow that anywhere.
Well, again,
I've never seen it allowed anywhere.
I don't think that this is a different situation because, again, these lots are fronting on Valley Street. If this were something where it was just some... You know, we're asking you to endorse a plan, create the frontage, and then just kind of ignore any of the other regulations. I wouldn't be here in front of you.
I thought zoning bylaw required frontage on a way and access to the lot.
Right. We've always maintained that we can't access our land from our frontage. We could mark the area.
You have a lot.
That's why we consulted with town council. We got the letter that we did.
Sure.
We prompted that question. Yeah. We went to the best legal mind we could determine to help us in the matter. Town council.
Sure.
He says, if it's an illusion and the board determines that way is illusory, then you don't have to approve that. It, in fact, doesn't have, shall we say, legal access. So that's the problem you still confront tonight. You have not solved that problem, right? It's still an illusion to us how you gain access. Except, as you say, if you folks would just help my client, do this other end-around type approach, you'll make everybody happy. Well, I'm not in the happiness business. I'm in the business of making sure that the zoning bylaws are complied with. If it's too much for your client to absorb a 300-foot cul-de-sac, then I guess that's his decision.
Well, again, and I don't want to... I'm not coming here tonight trying to, like, bulldoze this through. I was...
Yeah, you're never going to get that by us anyway.
Well, I was asked to come here...
By
the Conservation Commission, Mr. Clark.
Says, though, that you don't really
get this. I'm not here tonight trying to...
I think he's trying to use Mr. Clark as
I did not
leverage guy.
No, I did not. And I hope he would at least, you know, speak on this behalf. I never asked him to show up. It was his suggestion.
Yeah.
They were the ones who brought it up. I just said, sure, I would be willing to come back and take a few hits.
Yeah.
Because I think at the end of the day... that
conservation agent for the town to come to our meeting and hear this, because obviously he and the commission have their own concerns about what you propose.
You say it's $100,000 for one lot, part of me feels like the real problem was that when you did the first lot, you know, dividing that between two buildable lots isn't so extreme. Now we're talking about doing it for one lot, but really you're building it for two lots. The problem is you've already sold one lot. You know, so I'm sympathetic somewhat, but I feel like it's a little cute because half of the roadway or half of the access has already been built, and the owner has already gotten the benefit of that by being able to sell a buildable lot or a building. I'm not sure which he sold.
At the time, and I felt the same way. I thought that we were going to get a superseding order from the conservation. I mean, from the DEP on.
Well, then why did water bring up two lines there?
What's that?
Then why did the water department bring two lines?
There was there was already a line that was up there. That was my point. There was already a line that went in here for
the contract for built the first house.
When they built these houses on both sides, they ran a water main up here, and there was a service and a tap, and it was for a future development. So it was already there. So when they tapped in from this, they just...
Steve, when this was initially designed by your office, that was designed as a 50-foot right-of-way, correct?
No.
Why would you design a little two radiuses and a 50-foot easement?
Let me just say, it wasn't designed by us, is kind of what I was getting at. Originally, it was originally these were all designed, and there was 40-foot, and then it was, I can't remember the company that did it, but they revised every single one of the Form A's and widened these. It was probably in 2000, 2002-ish, if I remember, but they changed all of the Form A lots and then widened this one to 50 feet and then the other one down to 50 feet. So I just want to be clear, it was originally 40 feet.
Okay.
And then when they subdivided all these on Form A.
Why did they do that? The intent was to build a subdivision
to access into Duxbury.
Back up.
Yep.
Okay.
Well,
would you, the owner chose to build that cul-de-sac area, provide the frontage those two lots off of the cul-de-sac effectively, would you have to build any portion of that cul-de-sac in the town of Duxbury?
No, it would all be under your control, I would think.
Thank you.
I mean, I'm not sure I understood where you were going with the question.
Well, there is a solution that does not involve Duxbury, and the concerns you raised earlier about Duxbury not wanting to have a road originate in the town of Pembroke, they don't want us that road to be accessed to the lands in Duxbury, correct?
Correct.
And if you cul-de-sacked it at that point, you made no other thing, put a little spike strip in, if you will, and say, nobody's crossing over this into Duxbury,
mm-hmm.
which would be well within the rights of the ownership. But then, as the board is trying to suggest, that then you have a possibility, because now you have frontage that comes off of that stub.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody is happy that way, except, of course, the current owner, who now has to put out, apparently, according to you anyway, some additional funds to do that. But if they've all moved these lines, et cetera, this tells me that probably one time that might have been a 40-foot layout to what the town used to have, which was called a retreat lot.
Well, I think there were two 40-foots, and
you could have a 40-foot
open around.
You could have a 40-foot access into our retreat lot when we had that in town, but it's long been extinguished. But that was the requirement at that time, plus approximately 2+ acres of land to get a retreat lot recognized as a buildable lot. So, seems to me, along the way, somebody's retreat lot expired, and now we have that remainder land, and now it wants to be developed.
I'm going to disagree with that, because it would be foolish for somebody to build a retreat lot here having all of this available land in the back. I don't want to get into an argument with you. Neither one of us is going to be able to
cross that town line. Duxbury is a little tougher than we are.
Well, I don't know. I mean, to be honest with you, I just did a subdivision for this client over on the other side of 53, and they were actually pretty easy to deal with. Again, my feeling is that there is no plan to develop the land in Duxbury, so why would we go through trying to create a roadway to access this for one lot?
Honestly,
again.
I can't figure out why you're here the third time to get the same response.
Again, and I'm not trying to bring sympathy on myself, but I didn't come here because I was looking to get, you know, beat up one more time. I came here tonight because I was asked to come by the Conservation Commission because my client was proposing to do something that's, you know, it's within his right to do, but it's not something that he prefers to do, and it's not something that we felt the commission was better.
Well, Mr. Chair, is it fair to say that we're not comfortable with this plan that's been...
Indeed.
Yeah.
If I would say no.
Steve, I'm looking at 700 feet of road at roughly $50 a foot, $35,000.
Yeah, again, I think we're mixing the two separate things. Mm-hmm. We're talking about a driveway over here, and we're talking about a road.
Oh, okay.
They're not the same things. I don't know why.
Okay.
I mean, to construct a 4-inch wide with sidewalks and cul-de-sacs and granite curbing and everything that your requirement says, it's $400 plus a linear foot, and that's why. And so to do that, to get this, just doesn't make it feasible. To create this with some gravel that's here, some gravel that they're probably going to buy from the guy across the street, it's probably $15,000.
From an economic stance, we understand that's far more feasible, but from a Conservation Commission stance, it's not. That's, and I think from a planning board perspective, it is not.
That's why I'm here. But again, my client has options as far as what his rights are to do, and this would be one of those options, and it's not something that he prefers. I don't think it's something that they prefer. Not something that I would like to see again.
I'm not sure they...
We will...
Anyway.
We will move...
All right.
Well, I don't know what they're...
There's a dead horse somewhere feeling extremely battered.
Sure.
Go back to Conservation Commission and we'll see you in a couple of months.
All right. That's what
we'll do.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Modify
that
and
try to
do
a public hearing.
Yes.
We did
the language. We did the initial language change. Example.
You mean what they want to change?
There were one big issue was the depth.
But no, I think they also didn't want, and on the mixed use, they wanted the grandfather.
Right.
I mean, it doesn't matter what your depth is if you don't have that mixed use, right?
Yeah.
The mixed use that makes the, it's the juice.
Yeah.
Well, no, I don't think you want to have a Lowe's go in there that's 1,000 feet deep.
Oh, no, I'm saying from my restricted point of view, 300 feet. It's not overly restricted and proposed on the paper. But I'm saying that for the individuals I heard come before our public hearing process was they wanted the mixed use preserve and the 300 foot extended because they knew that that's how it could get really built.
Right.
So what they wanted was 300 feet or the depth of the current lot, and they wanted mixed use grandfathered for...
Forever,
we talked about 2 years.
No, not forever. We talked about a time
extension.
An extension.
Giving them time to try to get there.
I just mentioned some of the landowners
organized.
Yeah. I think we had said something like summer of 2028.
Well,
yeah, it'd be like a year or 15 months, something like that, to try to get your own plan together. We didn't agree to that.
2 years is more realistic, don't you?
Either way, you may still have a few property owners to say, one or two people saying, like, you know, we'd love to have the certainty of when we retire in 10 years. It's not a very strong argument, but...
It still only affects, I've gone through these maps a few times. It's not a lot of...
The costs are too small anyway.
It requires a combination of lots. You have to have more than one lot that shows
that. Well, we have the original draft of this language which would be tacked onto that. Do you want to take a shot at it?
Matthew, I'm sorry, I didn't bring my draft of the current language that we have.
I've got it. Actually, just want to see what's in the warrants.
Yeah.
I don't think I've copies down. So it's Article 18 and Article 19.
The folks that seem to be waiting here for something, I'm not sure.
Are you guys reporting or are you waiting to talk?
We're reporting. I'm reporting.
Waiting to ask some questions at the end of the meeting.
Oh, okay. About this or about something else?
About marijuana at the beginning.
Oh, okay.
So I think it's 18 and 19 there, two. I've got a few more copies, but I mean, basically it's just, you know, the 300 foot one is actually the much shorter article, since it's a pretty simple change. The lady makes use of all, changing a few places in the bylaws. Although conceptually it's pretty simple, of course.
So I think what we talked about on this was it shall include all that land that has frontage on the following ways to a depth of 300 feet or the current depth of the lot from said ways, whichever is greater.
That's common language?
No. Adding or the current depth of an existing lot.
So it'd be like at current depth as of something like as of May 9th, 2017 or something.
I think I understand where we're going with this. Wouldn't it be simpler or easier to simply state, you know, exempting a lot such and such, A1, A2, A3?
Well, no, because...
Again, because we only have specified lots where this would probably have an effect.
But what if those lots were later enlarged?
Well, I mean, you're saying these lots are exempted. So if two of them could get put together, well, they're supposed to be exempted.
Well, but then they could go as deep as they want to down the road.
No, you know where they...
They'd still be limited to the depth of the existing lot, not anything behind it.
Some of those lots go back from Madison Street, to be very specific here. Go back, perhaps three of them. They pretty much start at the funeral home and go, we'll say, to Smith
yeah.
Excavation.
Okay. Go a little further.
No. Not Smith. Everybody's within 300 feet. They're lots.
Are
so,
they?
Yes. If you want, it's better visually. Actually, more important document to observe is actually our assessor's map. Here's the point.
We're not their room.
Here's the point. That area that I just described, essentially from the funeral home to Smith, goes back from Mattakeesett Street. Their rear property line is the cemetery. Approximately, in some of those cases, about 550 feet to that cemetery back line. There is nobody further down Mattakeesett Street, going towards Grove and Warren, that have lots exceeding 300 feet in depth.
What about on Center Street?
Center Street on the side where the already built Pembroke Center is. That's
no, I'm talking about the one that was halfway built. Is that grandfather?
Halfway built.
The 204.
Yeah. The mixed use with the commercial.
The one that, what's his face, has.
That's Kill Commons Drive there.
That's
exactly 300 feet in depth, as a matter of fact. That is right up, kind of along the line, if you will.
The building part, the business part, or the whole lot is only 300 feet deep?
The whole lot is approximately 300 feet.
Is that true? Okay.
That building
that
back
into
the
housing authority.
Right, there's nothing behind it.
The condominium is built. That's not going to change.
Correct.
It's just the two lots in the front. The only one that's really affected on Center Street is the new one.
220.
He's got a problem.
There's going to that side of that road on the Center Street side. The house sits on the corner of Mountain Avenue currently.
Yeah.
Okay. And the proposed site.
Mm-hmm.
The very back of this Mountain Ave pointed site has a very small strip of land that's beyond 300 feet in the back because of the kind of an unusual shape of the lot.
Okay.
And that may have. I will say 30 feet roughly, by estimation, of beyond 300 feet. Okay. So you could, I guess, include
that into that exemption of lot that I've seen or suggested. Mr. McGill's issue is the 300 feet, plus, of course, there was originally about another 30-foot strip, we'll call it, behind that 300. Then he attained additional property.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Okay? And that also got him beyond the 300 feet.
Right.
So that's his concern right now.
I know.
Now, but are we looking to have this apply to that lot?
Well, you could exempt him. He's a, technically, he made application now. I know he's
right.
He's been considered as, well, you're...
I just don't want to end up in litigation for that.
Is, going to his own counsel was that, well, if you go forward with this, you kill our deal.
Right.
Essentially.
I think, honestly, we'd end up in litigation. And I
wish we went to good litigation earlier. It never would have gone to that litigation. But we chose a higher path.
All right, so the other... Is that clear?
I don't know which is easier to do, though.
I don't suggest nothing this evening. I suggest we come back if we want to take up this matter further, which I fully would entertain. I'll take up the deference of the article if we need to go that route. Be happy to try to meet with any of these parties and try to have them come out happy. But I just don't want to wing it.
Right. What this came down to was whether we were going to put new language out into a notice for a public hearing and have another public hearing before the town meeting. But if we don't have language tonight, then I don't think it makes sense to do another notice of public hearing.
No.
We could discuss some language before town meeting in an open meeting, but I don't think we have a full public meeting process.
No. We don't have to. If we went to amend it on town meeting floor, for instance, depth.
Yeah.
Okay. The only way you can amend an article is, in fact, the town meeting floor.
Right. This was going to be to have a public hearing on proposed amendments on town meeting
and
floor.
And we could still bring that up, and if we came up with an amendment that said 400 feet, or all the length of it, or all the
that's
depth
what we're
of it,
proposing, right?
That would be what the amendment would read on town meeting floor.
Right. But we,
get that
but we thought we should amend the language ahead of time, have a public hearing again to that language, so that we're not here on town meeting floor to put that forth without it looking like you did something.
Well, I don't think we need a public hearing
right there,
but I do think we probably want to. We have the list of
no public hearing
attendees, if you will, of a previous. We could notify them that we are having this discussion. And
well, we can do that, and I know public hearing isn't necessary, but it may be prudent.
You might be getting real close to deadlines between the advertisement requirement and the deadline.
I know, but I think we're close
did
enough.
We, technically yeah, are you saying that we should go to 400?
Yeah, you're close to it, yeah.
I'm not saying 400, maybe we just say the depth of the parcel and we exclude certain parcels. And we've done that before, we did that when we did
we
the...
Say, if we say to the extent of the existing parcels, that gives Mr. McGill that extra little lot he picked up, correct?
No, it doesn't because he hasn't bought it yet.
Oh, okay. Oh, who's that for?
Yeah.
From my, I don't know, like, I feel as though it would be great to just have sort of the simplicity of just saying this is the depth and that's it and not all these issues about this, which make it impossible to actually create an accurate
zone. I agree. I'd like to keep it at a 300 personally, but
or even have it be a bigger depth, but just say this is fixed.
Like a depth of 400 feet.
Like if we say 400 or 450, but it's fixed and that's what it is. But that's just my perspective, I guess.
Right.
It would simplify things, and maybe it'll make them happy too.
Folks, it's past my bedtime.
I'm going to make a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Wait, question.
Yeah. Did you want to question the meeting?
Commentary. Close up the meeting and I can ask from after that.
Okay.
Well, we can't have a discussion with all four, with all five members.
It would have to be just like two or three people.
It would just have to be
two or
three
or
people.
Three.
I just
need one person.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm the same way.
Okay.
Oh, okay. All right.
So before you adjourn, I guess, if you do want to do that public hearing, I guess, well, no, I guess we can discuss it later, I guess. Just let me, I mean, I would need to send it to the paper this week if we want to do the public hearing on May 1st for this. I mean, I don't want to do it before I go.
By the way, I have found that there is a bill that has been proposed at the State House to come up with a more uniform way for towns to opt in or out of the marijuana usage. And so there are people trying to address the issue of coming up with a more clear path for towns to address the inclusion or exclusion of recreational marijuana facilities within a town. And that is a bill that has been apparently
is it being held in committee?
Michelle Tesson, Area Election Legal Counsel and Director of the Secretary of State's Election Division, testified before the Joint Committee on Marijuana Policy to promote a bill Galvin filed with Rep. Angelo Scascia, can't pronounce that, that would clarify the process for cities and towns that wish to prohibit commercial marijuana establishments. So there is something that is, that's a news article as of today, where Secretary of State Galvin is looking to clarify the local process for controlling marijuana sales.
I'm glad we did what we did tonight.
So I think that what we did tonight is consistent with what the legislature is trying to do in addressing this problem, understanding the concerns of the towns, and trying to come up with a path that might make sense and be hopefully a little less